Welcome to the Offsiders Podcast with your hosts, Brendan Lang, Luca Mokan, and Massimo DeFranco.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to another episode of the Offsiders Podcast. I am Luca Mokan here with Massimo and Brendan once again. So, Massimo, why don't you tell us how this is going to go?
All right. So, the big news from Leafs land today is the trade. We're going to talk about the trade, dissect it. Got some other items to talk about in the rumor category, what's going on in the NHL with the teams that aren't in the playoffs. Then we're going to jump into some trivia, more of the NFL trivia. And then we're going to talk about why we picked what we picked for the round two matchups. As you've seen on our Instagram page, we posted our bracket. We're going to justify our picks, and then we're going to get into some questions to end it off.
All right.
So for those of you who haven't heard, I'll just go through the trade. The Leafs have traded right winger Kasperi Kapanen, left winger Pontus Aberg, and defenseman Jesper Lindgren to the Pittsburgh Penguins in exchange for a 15th overall selection, first round pick in this upcoming draft, left winger Evan Rodriguez, center Philip Hollander, and defenseman David Warsawski.
Warsawski, my boy.
Yeah. Kapanen was drafted by the Penguins back in 2014. His highest point total was 44 in 78. And then back in 2018-19 season, that's when he had the 44 points in 78 games. He's a very speedy winger. He's going to come down the wing with speed. He'll stop up and he'll look for a pass, or he'll shoot it into the goalie's chest. That's what he does. Plays power play and penalty kill.
Power right from a speed angle.
Yeah, pretty much. Plays power play and penalty kill. The critique with him is he struggles to finish off his scoring chances. What do you guys think about Kasperi Kapanen leaving Toronto, going back home?
So, I mean, I think as many people know, I was a big Kapanen fan. I liked how he provided a little bit of grit to the team. He was really fast, hell of a penalty killer. But at the end of the day, if he's kind of the first piece of the puzzle to getting this team to where everybody thinks they can be, like if he needs to go, then I'm not going to be mad. Like, I don't know a lot about the other players that we got, but hey, a first round 15th overall pick, I will happily take that.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's a good return, and I think, because they just shed some salary too, so now it kind of frees up maybe if they go out and sign a bigger name defenseman or something like that, then that trade can definitely help in that regard. Plus, the first round picks, definitely good things. The Leafs didn't have one at all this year.
Yep. So all we lose is Kapanen. We've talked about him. Pontus Aberg is just a depth forward, but he could probably see more ice time in Pittsburgh than he would in Toronto.
Pontus Aberg, did he ever play with the Leafs?
He played some games when we had that stretch of bad injuries.
Yeah,
I think he played like maybe three or two.
Yeah.
Jesper Lindgren, 22-year-old defenseman, hasn't really turned out the way the Leafs wanted him. And now getting into what Pittsburgh gives us, I'm very excited about this first-round pick because, in my opinion, there is no way Kasperi Kapanen is worth a first-round pick. And that in itself is a fleecing.
The fact that
they added on prospect Philip Hollander and Evan Rodriguez, Warsawski is just a throw-in, but Hollander is supposed to be a really good centerman. He has a high ceiling and he could turn out really well for this team. We've been saying for the Leafs is that we have a lot of forward prospects, but that's just not true anymore. Like, we have Semyon Durogan-Shintsev and he's like our best one left, because if Nick Robertson makes the team out of camp next year,
I think he's the last names
of two players. Massimo, can you say that guy's last name again?
Semyon Durogan-Shintsev.
Yeah, okay. I don't know how that's
going to be a stud anyways.
Philip Hollander definitely wouldn't hurt.
No, he'd be good. And Nick Robertson, I think it's almost a lock that he makes a team out of camp. Seeing the point production that he had in the OHL this year, I think it would just be kind of a backward step in his development to put him back in the OHL.
Yeah.
It was kind of the same thing with Marner. Like, they sent him back a couple times, but at some point it just became like, there's no way that this guy can play in the OHL anymore.
Mm-hmm. And like, I'm going to miss Kapanen, I'm going to miss his speed, I'm going to miss his like guaranteed breakaway on every penalty kill, but like, he's an expendable player. Like, we can replace him, sure. And he's definitely replaceable. There's definitely people who are like mad about this trade, but I don't think they see the bigger picture. Go on, Luca.
Well, and like, another thing for me is because I also watched the Steve Dangle video, because that's most quoted a couple times throughout this video. Yes. And it's like, it talked more about his role in Pittsburgh, and a lot of people are saying he's going to play in their top six. So, like, for him, kind of, because he always struggled to find a role on Toronto. Like, he never really fell into one thing. Like, he never found that one line, and he was like, yes, keep Kapanen with these players, and that's who he's got to play with. Like, he never really found that. So, for Pittsburgh, if he's going to constantly be in the top six and get some ice time with Malkin or Crosby, I think he can really kind of settle into his own there, because they originally drafted him.
And Jim Rutherford confirmed that Kasperi Kapanen will be in the top six. And for him, that means playing with Malkin or Crosby. And I don't think you can complain with either of that situation.
Yeah, I think I'd be pretty good with playing with either of them.
I worry for him, though, because when we put him into Leafs top six, he always struggled. But I think in a place like Pittsburgh, where he doesn't have much competition, where he does in Toronto, I think he might thrive a bit more. He definitely needs to work on his finishing, though.
Yeah, I mean, for sure. For a top six forward, you like to have somebody who can probably put the puck in the net a little better than he does. But overall, I think playing with guys like Malkin and Crosby, I think we just touched on, it's going to give him experience. So I think he'll do well over there.
Yeah. So where do you guys stand on this trade? Do you think it's a fleecing? You think they won? You think you can't really tell who won yet? Where do you stand?
So with most of the Leafs moves, especially with, you know, their trade, their big blockbuster trade last year, Kadri for Barry, like, you always really, really think one team won. And, like, on paper, honestly, I think the Leafs won, just because, like, a first round pick, considering especially that we didn't have one, is really, really good. But I think if this plays out and our first round pick isn't on the team, like, doesn't play on the Leafs for the next year or two, I think Pittsburgh wins the trade.
Well, and that's why I believe, like, what the smartest thing, the smartest option for me is, because of this trade, we've cleared up, we now have like $8 million in cap space, right? And this isn't the last move for sure, but I think what happens is they either flip the pick for something, or they draft the best player possible, not position wise. You don't look for a defenseman, you look for the best player possible, and then you use his value to get something in your turn. I don't think this draft pick stays on the Leafs.
Interesting.
Because the Leafs can't wait for another player to develop.
It's true. I do agree with that. That is a good point.
Well, I mean, I feel like that's another reason Pittsburgh traded it away, is because they can't wait either.
Exactly.
It's like, true. They know what Kapanen's worth. They know what they can get out of him. And Crosby's, what, 33 now? Like,
yeah.
You can't keep waiting.
And they're not going to commit to rebuild until Crosby and Malkin are off that
team.
For
sure. No way you can rebuild with Crosby and Malkin still on the team.
Yeah.
I don't think Pittsburgh fan base would be very happy with that.
For me, I think it's a fleecing just because Kapanen is not worth a first. We also get to clear up more cap space, and the most valuable thing you can have when you're trading is cap space. I think if it was just a first and Kapanen, like of Kapanen for a first, I'd be fine with that. But the fact that we got Philip Hollander as well, he could be, he's a question mark, but he has a high ceiling. Evan Rodriguez could play some games in a Leaf uniform. Dubit said he's going to talk to his agent, see what happens. Could be a fourth liner, third liner. But you never know. But I'm very happy with this trade, and I think this is why Kyle Dubas is a really good general manager.
I just think there's very, very few times where you can definitively say at the point of the trade that somebody really, like, somebody's a guaranteed winner, somebody's a guaranteed loser. So I think just looking at it purely on what they got back, it looks like the Leafs won, but I don't think we'll know for a year or two in the future.
Yeah, and you know what happened when the Leafs traded Phil Kessel to Pittsburgh?
Yep.
Won a cup.
Look what happened when they traded Kadri to Colorado. I mean, he's lost the first two games, but
apparently whenever you leave Toronto, you win a cup. So
Tyler Bozak.
JVR is yet to win a cup. See if that happens this year.
That's good.
I wouldn't be surprised if Kasperi Kapanen wins a cup next year, though.
Oh, I mean, yeah.
I thought Pittsburgh was going to win this year, bro.
Okay. So yeah, that's all we have for the Kapanen trade. Do you guys have any final thoughts or?
No, I think
Oh, okay. So if you want to laugh, there was a Sportsnet insider who was told that Cody Ceci was not happy with the time that he spent in Toronto, and he believes he's worth more money. Cody Ceci currently makes $4.5 million. John Klingberg makes $4.2
million. Well, John Klingberg, I don't know, probably took a pay cut because, you know, he's a humble player, but no Toronto player wants to do that. Cody Ceci can go rot in a dumpster there. And I would not miss him. See, like, I'd honestly rather a dumpster fire than Cody Ceci, because you can run away from a dumpster fire.
Oh my, if Dubas re-signs Cody Ceci at $5 million, I might cry. I think what Dubas wants to do, he definitely sounded like he wanted to sign Dermott, maybe to, like, a prove-yourself contract. And then he definitely wants to get Mikhaev signed. I think that was his first two priorities. But
I like Cody Ceci.
Yeah, I do too. Cody Ceci is definitely not on that list, and I hope not.
Yeah, for sure. I don't know. I don't think that'd be the smartest move to bring him back at anything more than what you're paying him now. Especially if he said he wasn't happy with his time in Toronto. I mean, there's no way.
Yeah, exactly.
Think about bringing him back.
Moving on to more rumors. The Oilers are now looking for the Oilers are now looking to veteran goaltender Freddie Anderson to solve their problems. Boys, this trade proposal makes absolutely no sense to me.
Give us Connor.
So the trade proposal they're offering, right?
So this is what Edmonton offered Toronto.
This is what Edmonton would like to offer for Freddie Anderson to Toronto. They want to offer Mikko Koskinen, Evan Bouchard, and a second round pick.
Is Evan Bouchard related to Eugenie Bouchard?
I don't know, and I don't care, because it's definitely not. Freddie
Evan Bouchard. That's a serious question. Evan Bouchard's going to be good, though, but I agree, it's probably too little.
Freddie is younger than
Freddie Koskinen. Freddie for Klefbom straight up.
No.
Why not? Klefbom is a great defenseman.
Yeah, but then you're left with no goaltending. Plus, Klefbom.
You have a defenseman, Massimo.
You might have to think about Clefbaum's contract.
And just get Jack Campbell to fill it.
Yeah, get Jack Campbell. Let me look up Clefbaum's contract. See if it's actually doable here. Oscar Klefbom has a cap hit of 4.1. You trade away Freddie. It's doable. I don't like it, because you. I think if you're trading away your goalie, you get a goaltender back most of the time. Yeah. Unless you're trying to free up cap space to sign a goaltender in free agency.
Well, who's their goalie? Cam Talbot.
Cam Talbot and Mikko Koskinen.
Okay. Well, I don't freaking want Koskinen. Okay. Talbot and Klefbom.
Actually, no. Sorry, it's Smith. It's Mike Smith.
That's right, Mike Smith. I forgot about Mike Smith.
Mike Smith and Oscar Klefbom for William Nylander and Frederick Anderson.
Mike Smith is so old. What are you talking about?
I don't care, Massimo. Okay, I want experience.
Mike Smith. Mike Smith is probably retiring.
Yes. Although the Flames have something. Yeah, no, I don't think the Leafs and Oilers make a trade. Like, they don't work with each other at all.
Give us Darnell Nurse.
That is the wrong idea.
What's wrong with Darnell Nurse?
How old is he?
Darnell Nurse? It's like 27, I want to say. I'll look it up. Darnell Nurse.
Is 25.
Okay, well, there you go. I don't think Edmonton wants to give up Darnell Nurse for anything.
Yeah, he's pretty good.
Yeah. All right, so Leafs and Oilers never going to make a trade. Moving on to our... Well, if they do, I mean, it better make sense.
Connor McDavid for Frederick Anderson. I'm telling you, everybody's sleeping on this.
Yeah.
That everybody wins.
Connor McDavid is $12.5 million.
Connor McDavid for Austin Matthews, straight up.
I don't think anyone says yes to that.
Say yes to that. I think the Toronto Maple Leafs say yes to that, Massimo. Are you on cocaine?
Yeah, of course. The Maple Leafs say yes to that. They're trading the best player in America for the best player in the world. Or sorry, second best. My bad. Moving from that front.
Is Austin Matthews the best player in America?
He could be the best American player. Who is better than him right now?
Patrick Kane.
True. Okay. I forgot about him. He's definitely top five.
Sure he's top five. 100%.
There's not much competition in America right now. As there much is.
Mark Stone.
No, he's Canadian.
He actually.
He played on the World Junior Canadian team.
Yes.
Okay. That was like 30 years ago.
What? Stone's not even very old.
No, he's not. He's like 26. Oh. I don't even. I'm going to stop guessing ages. It never ends well.
Mark Stone. Mark Stone.
Maybe 28. I'm going to say 28.
No way.
29.
Mark Stone is 28.
Let's go! After I guess 26, but yeah, it doesn't matter.
That's pretty good. I thought he was younger than that.
Yeah. So, a insider has rumored that Pietrangelo wants to stay with the St. Louis Blues.
Oh.
Only problem is the Blues have no cap space. They would have to commit to Pietrangelo, meaning they'd have to clear some space, like trading Tyler Bozak, trading someone who has more cap space as well. If they wanted to commit to Alex Pietrangelo, they would definitely have to move some guys, and it's if they really want to do that. If not, Pietrangelo will most likely be the most talented UFA this season.
For sure. In a couple seasons, he'll be, not many guys like him really come up on UFA. And I mean, if they do, they come back to Toronto. So,
You think Dubas is making cap space to sign Pietrangelo?
I mean, you'd like to think so.
I think he definitely saw the problems, but sorry, Brennan, go for it.
But I think you'd want to try, but I don't know if it's necessarily a reasonable request. Or I don't want to say request, I can't use the right word, but I don't think it's too reasonable that he actually comes to Toronto. I think that's a little out there.
If that does happen, you would have four players in the Leafs or five? Four or five making over $10 million.
Yeah, that wouldn't work.
Well, yeah. You better at least get to the second round after that.
Well, that's what I'm saying. It's not feasible for him to come here.
What I'm saying.
That's just like, that's another reason that I think you need to clear out some of these other bigger names. Not, you know, the two that I like, but, you know, I like them all. But whatever.
I get you.
You have to clear it out to make it more feasible so then you can get these depth guys on your lower lines. Like, because we need a demanding defenseman like Pietrangelo on the team. You can't get a bunch of no-name guys and expect to beat Washington, Boston, Pittsburgh. You can't
expect to do that. Yeah, that's true. But Pietrangelo, he solves your problems, but I don't think he's necessary. I think you need a guy who can play defense. That could be Dustin Byfuglien. That could be Radko Gudas. That could be Zach Bogosian. I don't think you're going to get a big-name defenseman if you don't move a big contract, and I don't think Dubas wants to.
You're going
to
have to move either, Martin.
You have to move a big contract, but at the same time, like, it was nice to think that we kept them, but it clearly doesn't work.
Yeah, so.
So I think they have to be moved whether you get a big-name defenseman or not. One of them has to go.
Well, I don't think you need to move them if you don't get a big-name defenseman.
If you don't get a solid return.
It's like if you just keep them all here and don't make a substantial enough change to really see a change in the team, you waste this season, you wasted your time.
You wasted an era. But yeah, Dubas already said he wants to see one more season from the top three because Tavares probably wasn't getting traded before he separated.
So Dubas doesn't care about the fans. Good to know.
No, he doesn't want to tear apart like such a young, talented forward group.
You know what he's been tearing apart, Massimo? My heart.
Yeah, me too, Luca. Me too. But actually, it wasn't him. It was Harold Ballard. But that's another.
Harold Ballard.
Who was that?
He used to be there. Nah, Harold Ballard. Harold Ballard is the worst.
Worst general manager for the Toronto Blues ever.
What about Dave Nonis?
Awful human being, too.
Yeah, Harold Ballard is an awful person.
Yeah. Another thing you don't really talk about that often is what we have coming in next season. You got Robertson contending. You got Alexander Barabanov. You got Mikko Lettinen. He could be a bottom defensive pair. You don't know what you have in him, but he could be an option.
Sandin, probably.
Yeah, Sandin will definitely be.
Sandin better make the freaking team.
I mean, he's good. It just still boggles my mind that he didn't play in the playoffs.
Yeah. I think Pierre Engvall probably stays on the roster.
I love Engvall. I think so.
Yeah, he's solid. But yeah, I'm very interested to see what we have in Barabanov and what we have in Sandin, because that could potentially, well, it won't make a huge impact, but if they're good, like really good, like Mikhaev was in the beginning, that could be a huge story.
For sure.
Especially if Mikko Lettinen can play really good defense. I think that's all the rumors I have for the hockey side and the Leafs side and the free agency side. So let's jump into some NFL trivia, Luca.
Alrighty. So I have two options for you guys today.
Ooh, options.
So we could do I have a couple teams here, and I give you guys a position and I go down the list, and it's whoever can name what player is in that position for the team first gets the point. Ooh. Or I have actual like descriptions of players.
You guys I do like the description, but it's up to Brendan.
It doesn't matter. If you want to do the description, Massimo, then we can do the description. It doesn't matter to
me. All right. We'll do the description.
Okay.
So, like, some are a little more drawn out, but some are very basic.
Okay.
So, I have nine, but they're not very long. So, it's best of nine. All right. Okay. Middle linebacker for the Baltimore Ravens who does not play anymore. Cricket noise.
I don't think I know a defensive player that's ever played on the Baltimore Ravens.
Okay.
I would just wait.
He played pretty recently.
Yeah, I mean, I know the only Baltimore – I don't even know if he played for Baltimore, but the only name that comes to mind is Jerry Rice, but he's definitely not a defensive player.
No, he's not.
Was he a running back?
He was a wide receiver.
He was a wide receiver. Okay, yeah, I know he wasn't a – did he play for the Ravens, though?
I don't think so.
No?
I'll check where he played. I want to say he played for the 49ers.
Yeah,
he played with the 49ers.
I don't have an answer for this question, Luca.
Yeah, the answer was Ray Lewis.
Ray Lewis. I've heard the name, but I never got that.
That's all right. Okay. The current quarterback for the Houston Texans.
Oh my gosh.
Massimo, if you did research, you definitely should know this.
I've definitely seen their logo, and I just don't, like, he's not ringing a bell.
This is so annoying. Yep.
He always threw to DeAndre Hopkins.
I've definitely seen his name.
He always threw to DeAndre Hopkins last season.
No, I know. I know who he is.
He was a discount Lamar Jackson.
Gosh, this is so annoying.
Nah, nothing's coming to my mind.
Just give me a second. I can't even think of his name.
Yeah, clue for the name, Luca?
I want to say... It starts with a D.
It does.
No, I can't think of his name.
D and his last name starts with a W.
Yeah. Why can't I think of something? Deshaun Watson.
There you go. Deshaun Watson. Yeah. Point, Brandon.
Yeah, I've definitely heard his name. I just couldn't remember.
Okay. This player does not play anymore, primarily known for his wide receiver career on the Minnesota Vikings and the New England Patriots. He had a saying in football named after him when you would catch the football over two receivers.
The Odell?
No.
Odell Beckham Jr. Moss.
There you go. Randy Moss. You got Moss.
I did just get Moss.
The Odell.
The Odell. That's Odell a good guess.
Still plays. he's disappeared a little bit in the league, but
yeah, he's still here. Has. He's still on Cleveland.
It's more of a personality.
He is still on Cleveland. I was going to put him here, but I was worried you guys weren't going to get him. Okay.
Probably. Anyways, yeah.
This player currently plays for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, had most of his career in New England, and is a tight end.
Great.
There you go. Wait, I tricked you.
Yeah, you tricked me.
I tricked you.
I heard tight end. Like, no. Wait, they're on the same team again? Damn.
Yeah.
Well, Brady basically brought Gronk out of retirement.
But... yeah.
Okay. A wide receiver who used to play for the Pittsburgh Steelers, New England Patriots, and is currently on the Las Vegas Raiders, but has not played a single game in, I think, 15 straight games in the NFL, surrounded in controversy for his crying on Twitter last year about the new helmets in the NFL.
Antonio Brown. I think I got that one.
Asmo got that. Antonio Clown himself.
Oh. I didn't know Las Vegas had a team.
It was originally Oakland, but they moved.
That's right.
That's what I thought, yeah.
Last year. Okay. This one should come pretty quickly. Current quarterback for the New Orleans Saints.
Drew Brees.
Mm-hmm.
I'm blanked there.
Okay, Massimo, you have to get the next three to tie.
Massimo, comeback season. Let's go.
I doubt either of you are going to get this, but the current quarterback for the New York Jets.
New York Jets. No, I should know this.
I think I know this.
Well, it's not Sam Darnold, is it?
Yes, it is.
Oh, is it? Okay.
It is. Oh, I actually knew that.
Why did you say it then?
I forgot his name.
For some reason, I thought Sam Darnold was the quarterback for the Giants, but
no, that's Daniel Jones.
Oh, that's right, Daniel Jones. Yeah, wasn't he like he was? Like, they drafted him, like, too early. Like, well, he was expected to go later in the draft.
Like, all the Giants fans were really, really mad when they drafted him. And then he came in when Eli Manning wasn't performing, had, like, two ridiculous games, and then he just kind of veered off later in the season. But, okay. An offensive juggernaut for his team, being in the top two picks of almost every fantasy football league, a running back for the Carolina Panthers. Massimo,
I'll let you get this one. I know the answer.
Did he play for the Seahawks?
No.
No, but I'm interested to know who you thought it was.
Marshawn Lynch.
No, he still plays on the Seahawks.
What team is he playing? The Panthers.
He plays on the Seahawks?
Yeah, he went back for playoffs last year. But, okay. He currently plays on the Carolina Panthers.
Oh, Christian McCaffrey.
Thank you.
Good job.
I got him from the last trivia.
He's the most skilled player in the league. Next to maybe Lamar. But okay.
Thank you, Brendan. Appreciate it.
I don't think either of you are going to get this, but the current outside linebacker for the Denver Broncos, pretty well known in the league.
Oh, my gosh. Outside linebacker.
He's pretty much the only defensive player you'd know on the team. Like, when I say his name, if you don't get it, you'll go, oh, okay. I think.
Yeah, I mean, I'm trying to think, like, I'm just trying to think of defensive players that I even know, like, J.J. Watt obviously doesn't play there. What's his name? Your favorite guy.
Aaron Donald,
of course, he doesn't play there.
Yeah, I don't have
Khalil,
one.
Khalil Mack doesn't play there.
Khalil Mack's a linebacker.
Yeah, I know, but he plays on what, the Bears?
Yes.
How many damn positions are there? Jesus.
11 offensive.
And then your favorite, your dinosaur friend, Whitworth or whatever his name is.
Andrew Whitworth. Yeah, he's four. He's on offense, but.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, he's an offensive.
He's an offensive tackle. All right.
Yeah, I don't know.
Vaughn Miller.
Okay, yeah, I did know the name.
Yeah. Like, I think, like, if you somewhat follow football, you just know his name.
I didn't know he was on defense, actually. I thought
Vaughn Miller was.
No, he's athletic as hell, though. He's like 6'5", I think.
No, I do know Vaughn Miller.
Yeah, he is. How tall is he? Or you can just tell me all his stats and not his specs, okay? He's 6'3", 250.
Oh.
Jesus, compare that to the 6'3 player in the NHL.
Compare that to you, Massimo. He's like double your weight.
I don't want to talk about that.
6'3", Massimo.
No, Massimo's my height.
I'm 6'1". I've confirmed it. You got any more, Luca?
No, that was it. Right. Brendan won that 5-2.
I think I'll have a. I think my best shot of actually competing is in baseball.
Really?
Yes.
I think that's such a count.
You did think the Blue Jays catcher's name was Ricky Martin.
No, but like.
Okay, yeah.
I thought I would be good in basketball, but all the players that I knew, they're gone. But I think I'll be better in baseball. I know some players.
Is that the last one for NFL, or are we going to do one more?
I think we have one more.
Okay.
I'll try and make that more fun. And I'll keep it all current players. I'll make sure it's all offense.
All right.
Continue.
Do you guys have your current brackets up, like your picks?
Yeah, go and get them up here.
Yes, I do.
All right. So, for the West, first series we're going to review, Vegas versus Vancouver. For me, it's going to be a really good one, as well as a goalie battle, because Robin Leonard and Jakob Markstrom also been insanely good right now. Players to watch, Pettersson, Miller, Hughes, Riley Smith, Mark Stone, Shea Theodore. I'm going to take Vancouver in six, and I won't be surprised if Vegas takes it as well.
So I had it Vegas in seven. Yeah, I think it'll be really close series.
Yeah, it's gonna be really
close. Basketball
kind of covered everything there. I got Vancouver in seven. So, but again, either way, I'm not gonna be surprised if Vegas wins. But I do think it will go six or seven games.
I mean, yeah. Didn't Vegas just slap them yesterday?
Yeah.
I bring it up. Yeah, they. Right now, Vancouver's winning 2-0 at the end of the first, and Vegas leads 1-0 in the series. So what happened in that game, actually, is funny you brought it up. I don't know why, but Vancouver decided it was fun to mess with Ryan Reeves, and Ryan Reeves decided, no, don't do that. And I'm like, if they don't poke the bear, like, they're fine. Like, don't mess with Ryan Reeves. He can't score. What do you care about him? Like,
who was the guy that was hugging him?
Antoine Roussel, I think.
Yeah, Antoine Roussel. Yeah, that's right.
And why would you do that?
That was pretty funny. But
I think if they stick to the offensive side of the game, don't try and play Vegas's game, they could probably take the series.
Yeah, true.
All right, Colorado-Dallas. It's set up for a huge upset right now, as Dallas has been getting hotter and hotter. Players to watch, you got MacKinnon, Kadri Makar, Dennis Gorjanov, Pavelski, Miro Heiskanen. I took Colorado in six. I believe in them.
That's still possible.
It's still possible.
Mine's already not. I have Colorado in five.
So did I. I had Colorado in five as well. It's already gone.
See, I gave it six because I definitely think that the Dallas Stars are capable of taking two games off the Avalanche because they've been getting hotter and hotter, and they actually know how to score again.
Well, you would be correct if that was your diagnostic, so good job.
Off of that one's actually an interesting development. Grubauer has gone down, so it's Pavel Bruce's crease.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
I mean, is there any timetable on his injury? You know,
I don't know. I don't think they revealed it.
Huh?
Because you know they don't. It's big probably blow. Just you know unfit to play.
Yeah. It's a big blow, though.
Yeah, for sure. But I think Francis can do it.
I mean, like every team has to suffer some kind of blow. And I mean, I honestly hope this doesn't at least just go beyond this round. But it's like if Colorado can beat a team like Dallas without Grubauer, like I think that really shows what a force they are, even though people already thought that before.
Yeah, also, Dallas does not win game two if it's not for Anton Khudobin. Guy is having an absolute rocket of a playoffs right now. He saved 38 saves and had a .950 save percentage in game two when the Dallas Stars won 5-2. If Khudobin doesn't play that well, the Avs definitely take the series because they can score. But Hudobin's not allowing them to do that, and they're struggling.
Yeah, that's right.
What's
I think
going on in that series.
Yeah, what the goalies is that it's not like anything like a stat that you can quantify or anything, but
yeah.
Sometimes with the players, there is a comfort level playing in front of the goalie that like you're used to and like you know.
Yeah, for sure.
And it builds your confidence.
Be there. So, yeah, it helps your confidence for sure. So that could be a disadvantage with Colorado. not saying that it should affect them in winning the series because they are the superior team. But yeah, sometimes that definitely plays a factor into it. Not that that's an excuse that would let them lose the series, but I can see why they could have a tough time.
Yeah. Currently, right now, Dallas leads the series 2-0. Yep. Game 3 is tomorrow. Right. All right. Well, today when you hear this. Okay, into the East, you got Philadelphia versus the New York Islanders. Who do you boys have?
Brendan, who do you got?
I have the Islanders in 7.
I think I have Philly in 6.
I have Philly in 5. Or sorry, not Philly in 5. Islanders in 5. I got a hot take on this series, and I think it's just going to be a steamroll from the Islanders.
Wow. That's interesting.
And I'll justify that by saying the Islanders are a perfect counter for the Philadelphia Flyers. They're able to shut down the offense of the Washington Capitals, so I don't think the Flyers will be a struggle, as well as the Flyers' power play has been abysmal, and the Islanders are the better 5-on-5 team. So all signs for me are pointing towards the Islanders taking this with ease.
Have any games been played in this series yet?
Yeah.
Yes.
The Islanders.
The Islanders won the first game 4-0.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. The Flyers really got to get going offensively because the Islanders will punish them.
And the Islanders' defense is good, too. I'm a big fan of what they got. And Barry Trotz, a great coach.
Yeah. You're high on Barry Trotz, Brendan.
I am.
He's a solid coach.
I really like Barry Trotz.
Brendan, did you have the Islanders over the Caps?
I didn't. I did not know.
Okay. Well, yeah. Barry Trotz, really solid coach. Yeah, Barry Trotz.
I like the Islanders, though.
Yeah, for the Flyers, you got to watch players like Voracek, Kevin Hayes, and Ivan Provorov. They got to start getting going. You got to get more contribution in the offense, too, as they've been hot, but they've died off as in they entered to this first round.
Definitely.
For the Islanders, Bailey and Anthony Beauvillier and Matt Barzal have been outstanding.
Bailey, that's my boy right there.
Yeah.
Anthony Beauvillier, too.
My dad's friends with his dad. Pretty cool stuff.
Wow. So
you can get us some tickets.
Yeah.
Tickets. Brendan, you have stadiums. What do you have for this series, Brendan? I don't remember. Sorry.
I have Islanders in 7.
Okay, so Luca has the Flyers. I have the Islanders. Brendan has the Islanders. Now,
I mean, my bracket's pretty much entirely collapsed, but yeah.
Yeah, I think all our brackets are collapsed if Colorado doesn't get past Dallas.
Well, it's also because of the reseeding. Like, it just messes everything up. Yeah. If you get even one thing wrong.
Yep.
I don't really understand that.
Like, do they not do this in NBA? Should
have just been seeded 1-8 and then go from there. Yeah, like, not constantly reseed after every round.
Yeah, is that how it usually is?
Yeah.
Yes.
I don't reseed after every round.
Damn. I think they just wanted to always have like they never wanted to have like a 1v2, like a 1v2 match. I think they always wanted to have like a best matchup possible.
That would happen in the conference finals.
Yeah,
if both teams make it, yeah.
But I mean, 1-2 in the conference finals, wouldn't that be a good thing?
That'd be great.
Best teams in the conference final.
But to get that, you gotta have like you can't have a 1-2 in the round 2. Right, because then one of them gets eliminated.
I don't think you would if you had...
Whatever, this is a pointless argument.
Okay, final series, you got Tampa versus... at the end of that... Yeah, Tampa versus Boston. I have Tampa in 6.
I got Boston in 5.
I have Tampa in 7.
Tampa won tonight, so the series is tied 1-1.
They barely won.
They barely won. Yeah.
In overtime.
Overtime.
Didn't Boston win overtime too?
In the first game, I want to say they did. Let me take a quick check.
One thing, sorry, Massimo, while you check that, one thing that I found really interesting about this series is that Vasilevsky has not showed up.
Yeah. No, man, they just won in regular.
He had an .880 today.
Mm-hmm.
Let 3 goals in. I mean, to be fair, Halak wasn't great either. He had a .900 save percentage. But
Halak is the better goalie right now, though.
Like, that's scary. Boston didn't even need Rask, and they still almost pulled this game out.
Halak is also a playoff performer, always.
Yeah, I know, but Montreal and Carey Price got hurt. So that was crazy.
So should Vasilevsky. He should be even more of a playoff performer. And he
for sure, lost
it. But like he had 25 save or 22 shot, 22 saves today. That is terrible.
If he keeps letting in goals that easy, I think this will be over for in a flash. But for me, I got Tampa at 6. I think that this is going to be a huge test if Tampa is capable and ready to elevate their game to get to the Stanley Cup final and contend for a cup. And I think it's also going to be interesting to see how good Halak really is.
I just think I would not be at all surprised if Boston takes this one. Like, I kind of reluctantly put down Tampa Bay. But yeah, I think Tampa Bay just really needs to prove that they can win because of last year's sweep to Columbus. And exactly. Stamkos, so I mean,
Boston's playing without Rask, so that kind of evens out.
Well, I mean, right now it's not even a factor because Halak is arguably playing better than Rask did.
Well, I mean, Halak had a 900. That's not playoff material. Like, it wasn't playoff material on either side, but I expect more out of Vasilevsky than I do out of Halak.
Yeah. Players to watch, you got Braden Point, who's looked outstanding. Nikita Kucherov, same. Victor Hedman, just a solid defenseman. Ryan McDonough has
Blake
gone down.
Coleman scored two today.
Yeah, Blake Coleman. The line of Blake Coleman, Barclay Goodrow, and Yanni Gord, outstanding. Very, very good line of Tampa. Yeah. Ryan McDonough went down with an injury, so Luke Shen, Zach Bogosian are going to have to patch that. I think they're playing with seven defensemen today.
My boy Kevin Shattenkirk got an assist.
Yep.
That is if you can get him on your fantasy team, that's one of the best fantasy names you can get.
Yeah.
No one will
look for him also.
Yeah, but you know what? He's got a playoff point, so
mm-hmm.
I'll take him on my fantasy team.
Interesting. Krejci's leading Boston in points. So you got Krejci, Marchand, and McAvoy, probably their best players right now. Krejci has looked outstanding, and I don't understand why.
I mean, Krejci didn't get a shot on net today.
Well, probably just a bad game, but yeah.
He's looked outstanding. No shot.
There was a game, so I said, but yeah. Langer, you have anything to say?
Oh, I think you guys covered it all.
All right. That's our brackets. You guys still have Colorado in the Stanley Cup, winning the Stanley Cup, right?
Yep.
I think we all do.
If who's your finals, by the way?
Colorado, Philly. Colorado.
Okay. Brendan?
I have Colorado, Tampa still.
Okay. So if Tampa can't come back, but they already tied it, but let's just say Boston wins. And Luca, let's say Islanders win. Who would you have in the final with Colorado?
Boston Islanders?
Hey, you know what? Actually, sorry. If both teams struggle to make it to the final, who's your new final?
What do you mean?
Yeah, what do you mean?
Like, both teams you have in the final currently, if they both get out.
So if Colorado and Philly both get out, I'll take Vegas, Boston.
Okay.
I'll take Dallas, Boston.
I would take Dallas Islanders. But yeah.
That is such an unorthodox final.
Have you met me? I am unorthodox.
No, but I mean, it's definitely possible. Both those teams are playing good hockey right now.
Yeah, Luca, I'm the definition of a hot take.
Like, it's just crazy to think. Like, I was talking with my dad yesterday. We were talking, like, I don't know how the Islanders are doing so well. And it's like, oh, you know, like, they don't have a superstar. And we started naming off their players. And it took us forever to realize we forgot to say Matt Barzal. And we were kind of like, what the heck? But it's like he may be their best player, but he's not like a Sidney Crosby or a Connor McDavid kind of guy. Like they played very similar, or I think they're playing similar to how first-year Vegas played.
Yeah, Barzal isn't like a household name yet, as of yet, because
– still pretty young, too.
He's young, and he plays a defensive style that the Islanders play. If he was in Toronto or a bigger market where like they play more offense, I think you definitely hear more of Barzal. But because he plays more of the defensive aspects of the game and his team is more of a defensive style and a system, then it definitely benefits them being able to shut down players and teams. And that's why you don't hear much of Barzal, because he's playing more defense than offense. Okay, into the questions. I have four questions, all very interesting. Three of them are UFA related. One of them is just a fantasy thing. Okay. Taylor Hall has said that he wants to commit to winning before money. His first priority is finding a team who is a Stanley Cup contender. So if not Arizona, where do you think he ends up?
Dallas.
If he's taking a pay cut, he's going to go join the Pittsburgh Penguins.
No, I think Dallas makes the perfect sense. Like, I Dallas is a perfect fit for Taylor Hall. You want to go to win, and you want to go to a team that's struggling for offense? Dallas.
Or you could go to Pittsburgh and play with the best player in the world.
Yeah, you could, but, like, do you trust the forward?
Ilya Brzdialov isn't on Pittsburgh.
Why do you have to be mad?
Greg McKegg isn't on Pittsburgh. Yeah, I think Dallas is a perfect fit. Pittsburgh could work, but I don't see them winning a cup. I think they're done. I think dark days are ahead of Pittsburgh, if I'm honest.
If they got Taylor Hall, you don't think they'd?
No, I think they could definitely contend. I just don't think they'd win a cup.
Interesting.
I think they could still contend next year even without him.
As long as they have Crosby and Malkin on their team, they're gonna contend. I'm just saying dark days are coming.
Yeah, but that's years in the future.
But they can't really control, like, if Crosby or Malkin has a bad season and they start to tank. Like, that, they can't. It's not gonna happen.
Malkin had, like, a really bad season 2 years ago, comes out of nowhere, comes off an injury this year, and I'm pretty sure he still got, like, 90 points.
Yeah, that's the type,
like,
of player.
Neither of those guys are just going to start slowing down out of nowhere. That's not what happens to spectacular hockey players like both of these guys. That's not how it works.
For sure. All right, so that's the Taylor Hall aspect. We're going to move into Arizona again. They're looking to move Oliver Ekman-Larsson. They feel that he is not progressing. The Leafs can't take on his contract. So where do you think he ends up? Well, I mean, the Leafs could take on his contract, but
Seattle.
Don't think he ends up
in Seattle.
I don't think he ends up in Toronto anyways. So I'm going to go with that's a tough one, actually.
For me, I feel like Ottawa makes some sense.
Ottawa. I'm going to say Philadelphia.
What, Luca?
Hey, no GM or manager. I guess that's what a GM is. No GM with a heart and no player with a brain is gonna say, hey, let's go to Ottawa.
They have some prospects in development. They just need more.
But they're not going to trade away prospects for Oliver Ekman-Larsson, though.
No.
He's not going to make that drastic change that Erik Karlsson made. And even then, Erik Karlsson wasn't the only player on the team.
That's not what I'm saying. It's just Ottawa is in a rebuilding phase, and they're not going to trade away their prospects.
Yeah, I don't know what you get for OEL, if I'm honest.
I don't know.
But I don't think he'll be an Arizona Coyote for next season.
I think he goes, you send him over to Philly and just shore up the defense there. They got a lot of young guys on offense.
Who do you send to Arizona?
Oh, I have no clue.
Ghost Bear in, like, a package?
Yeah.
Well, you can't.
He doesn't really have much value, though. It's tough. Going on to the third item, Calgary Flames. They're open to trading Johnny Gaudreau because they feel that he is not present enough in the playoffs. He's great in the regular season, but he disappears for them in the playoffs. They want to see more out of him. Where do you think
he is? Doesn't that just suck? Don't you just hate when a player does that for your team?
Where do you think
Johnny Gaudreau ending up with the Minnesota Wild?
That could work.
The Western Ottawa.
Yeah. The Calgary Flames have been, they're basically the Western Leafs.
Well, no, they still have, I think, They have some brighter years ahead of them.
I don't think so. I think the Leafs
have. That's your opinion, Massimo. That's your opinion. Okay, Johnny Gaudreau. You know what? Winnipeg.
I want to hear the justification for why Winnipeg.
I don't know. I think Winnipeg, like, they have the good, like, they have a lot of good offensive players, but I think him being really young adds another element to their, like, to their power play. Like, they already have a really, really good team, mm-hmm. and they still took it to Calgary even without some of their really good players. And I think, I don't know, him adding that other piece of the puzzle. I don't know how they're doing contract-wise or cap-wise, but I think if they could get him, I think he'd be a really interesting fit to Winnipeg.
I actually can't believe Johnny Gaudreau is 27.
Yeah.
He is?
Yeah.
Nathan MacKinnon is 3 years younger than him.
Yeah. Crazy. Gaudreau's been in the league way longer than you think.
Oh, my God.
For me, L.A. makes a lot of sense. But I don't know what they get in return.
6 full years in the league.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's crazy. L.A., I mean, yeah, L.A. is kind of on the down right now.
They need pieces to rebuild, though.
They do, they definitely do. I don't know if you'd be able to give up enough out of L.A. to get Gaudreau there.
I don't even know what L.A. can offer.
Yeah, exactly. Like, I mean, I have no clue. But
Drew Doughty?
No. I don't think Calgary wants Drew Doughty and Mark Giordano, both those contracts on the same team. That's a yikes.
You have one good year to make something happen, and then they're both going to turn to dust and bone.
You do. I just thought of one quick one. What would you guys say if by the end of – no, sorry, by the end. By the start of next season, Dustin Byfuglien's a Leaf.
I've talked about Byfuglien on the Leafs, I think, for like the past 5 episodes. I love him. I want him. I want him.
But do you worry that he, because he missed a whole season, he doesn't perform as he would if he didn't miss that season?
See, but he doesn't even need to. Like I don't think he needs to take as offensive of a role as he did.
No, he doesn't.
Would it be nice? I'm like, yes, but I'm just saying, if that guy can go around and be a defensive wall, and actually people would be scared to go into the corners with him like they haven't been for a Leaf in years, yes, that's what I want.
Yeah.
That's what I want. That's it.
The bar is low for Byfuglien if he comes, because he just has to be better than Ceci.
That's it. Okay, a little better than Cody Ceci, but like I feel like, I don't know, I could name players that were on my high school hockey team that were better than Cody Ceci, but...
I could definitely think of some too. Anyway, the final one. This one's a bit of a thinker, so.
Yes.
So a dynasty in the NHL has been described as a team who can win at least 3 Stanley Cups within a 10-year span. So that's what we're going to go off of. With that said, which NHL team do you think is the closest to that, or do you believe could be a future dynasty?
Like right now?
Within the next 10 years.
Oh, like not has been. Will be.
Will be, yes.
Colorado. It's the basic answer, but they're so friggin' young on that team. Their captain's, what, 28? And
Landeskog was the youngest captain in history, yeah.
Yeah.
I always forget Landeskog's not 35.
No, like he looks like he is, but he's not.
Yeah. What do you have, Brendan?
I mean, Colorado, yeah, I agree with that one. That was going to be my pick, too. But I still think Edmonton has a shot at it, too.
Yeah, they could definitely be a dynasty if they have the best player.
Yeah.
The second best player.
No, for years to come, he's going to be the best player, for sure.
Yeah. I think it's going to be the Toronto. No, I'm kidding. It's definitely Colorado, man. Like, they have so many – Braden Byram hasn't played a freaking game for them yet. Connor Timmins hasn't played a game for them yet. Alex Newhook hasn't played a game for them yet. And they still have cap space. Like, this team is scary good and scary good, I think.
The best player on that team didn't want money.
I think they need, like, maybe some defensemen, maybe one. Actually, no, they don't need a goalie. They need a goalie. I don't think you can rely on Pavel Francouz or Philip Grubauer.
I think Grubauer is a very reliable. I just think you need a good backup. Like even if you go with a tandem of two all right goalies, I feel like that's kind of becoming a big trend in the league, is you don't necessarily need one dominant goalie. As long as you have two decently reliable goalies, you're okay.
Yeah. What you're seeing in the league this season, for sure, is it's no longer like really good starter and backup. It's now tandem. Tandems are the way to go right now.
For sure.
That's all I have for today, boys.
Yeah, good episode.
Next episode, I think the second round may be over. Some series could be over.
Yeah, that's right. We should talk about that.
We're currently at 90 followers on Spotify. So if you don't follow us already, we're 10 away from 100. So do that.
I'll make fake accounts.
Yeah.
Don't force me to make fake accounts.
We are still making YouTube videos. So if you don't have Spotify or you don't like listening to podcasts on Spotify, we have a YouTube account. I'm going to look into finding a way to get our podcast on Apple Podcasts as another streaming site. Yeah. See you for the next episode.
Great. Yes. Thank you so much. Have a good one, everyone.